you consider Hashem as a father, as a mother, He will be next to you.
Permission of Hashem, today we are going to talk about the wells that Yitzhak Avinu he dig. Today, Baruch Hashem, you have water. You just open up the robinet and you have the water. But that at that time, there was no water. You have to dig wells to have water. And there is a story. And the story is that Yitzhak Avinu, he was digging wells for people. So the Philistine, what he did, the Torah said, all the wells that his father Sarah had dug in the days of Abraham when his father was alive, the Philistine stopped it up and filled them with earth. And then Avimelech said to Abraham, go away from us because you become more stronger than us. Get out of here. So the Torah said, and Isaac, Yitzhak Avinu, dug a new wells again. A new, the wells of water. And you open up again all the ways that the Philistine, they fill it with earth, he anew them again. And the Philistine again stopped them after his father's death. And the Isaac's servant dug in the valley of, and they defend there a well of fresh water. And there was, and they quarreled about this well. The Torah tells us about wells, borot. They dig them. And the other people, they fight with them, they quarrel. They fill them with water. Then again, the servant of Isaac, again, they dig them again. And they call them Sitna because it was a fight. And they went somewhere else. There, they dig again. And they did not quarrel over it. So he called them Rehovot. Rehovot from the word. Now we have space, and we can be fruitful in this land. And he went up from there to Beersheba, and Hashem appeared to him that night, and he blessed him. What happened after? He built an altar there, a mizbeah, and he invoked the name of Hashem as his father. His father, Abraham, wherever he goes, he invoked the name of Hashem. Whatever he do, he teach people, whatever he do, there is Hashem. Look what happened. And there, he pitched his tent. And there, Isaac's servant dug a well. Again, we talk about a well. Okay? And then Abimelech, the one, the king of Philistine, the one who told him, go out, go from us, he went to him, and he did with him a peace, and he told him, let's do a peace again. And they did a dinner, and they ate together, and he made them a feast, and they ate and drank. And the morning, they woke up early, and they swore to one another. Then Isaac showed them off, and they departed from him in peace. And look what happened again. The servant of Isaac came to Isaac, and they told him about the well that they had dug. And they said to him, we have found water. So the name is Shiva. Shiva is from Beersheba. Therefore the name of the city is Beersheba until this very day. I mean, look. I do not understand. Why the Torah has nothing to tell us? Only about digging a well? I mean, the Torah, there is so many things that the Torah talk about. Okay, what is the story here? Is this a story when just imagine Lehavdil, imagine Obama, the president of the United States. He is one of the biggest, powerful men in the world. He go to somewhere, and then the news, they tell you, when he arrived, they told him, we found a well here. And they told him, dig a well here. I mean, can you imagine just in the news, they tell you something so much important that somebody, he dig a well and he find there water, fresh water. And there was a fight and they fill it off water. I mean, you know what it is, Torah? Every word in the Torah has a meaning. I mean, I don't understand all these pages. A lot of psukim that the Torah talk about, instead of Torah tell us a story, a real story about Isaac, like the story that when he arrived to Philistine and they nearly raped his wife. Okay, and a miracle happened. Okay, this is a small story when Hashem appeared to Yitzhak. It's very important. How many times Hashem? That means if Hashem appeared to Yitzhak, that means that Yitzhak is a big tzaddik. We understand, okay? But to tell us about fighting about well, the puits, I don't understand. The Torah tell you, and they fight about this well, and then they fill it with earth, and then he dig another well. And then there was a problem. There was a quarrel. And then Avimelech told him, get out from here. And then he, okay, that maybe there is something that the Torah want to teach us that after they saw that Yitzhak was protected by Hashem, so they came to ask him sorry. Okay, but what happened again? He built a Mizbeah a altar of sacrifice, and he called him by the name of Hashem, and then he dig a well, and then there was a peace with Abimelech, and after the peace, the servant came to tell him, "Hey, we found a well in Be'er Sheva." What does it mean? What it is the secret? Of course, there is something that we have, we must understand. It's not nothing that if the Torah tells us this, that means there is a meaning. We must know something. Torah is full of secrets. And this is our problem, to find the secret of the Torah and to understand them and to teach it. All what the Torah said is for generation. Maybe we don't find any connection what the meaning of all this. But of course, if the Torah tells us this story, this psukim, that means there is a meaning. So the question is, what it is the meaning? I was thinking that, listen to this, huh? What it's hiding behind this story of wells, that we have to know that we compare the Torah to the water. And we compare the wells as the secret of the Torah. That means that you have to dig. To understand the Torah, you have to be hofer, dig. I mean, if those people who work in the mines to find diamonds and gold, they have to dig, to search. It's not easy. And then they find diamonds. Then they find gold. Everything that has a value, you have to suffer to get it. To have a good diamond, you have to suffer. You cannot find the diamond in the street, in the water now. You have to dig very, very, very deep inside the earth and dig maybe 100 meters, maybe 200. It's dangerous, but this is the risk. This is the risk. The risk to find the risk. If you would be rich, you have to suffer. Yitzhak is the symbol of the Gvura. Yitzhak is the fighter. The Torah would to teach you that the education that Yitzhak received from his father, he followed step by step the education of his father. And there is here something incredible. When the Torah said all the wells that his father's servant had dug in the days of Avraham, his father's life, the Philistines stopped it up and filled them with earth. There is here something incredible, that all the yeshivot, all the place of Torah that Abraham opened up, when he died, the Philistine or other people, they stopped, they closed them, they shut them down, they shut them up. Why? There is no Rosh Hashiva, there is nobody to take care of them today. And it's Hakabinu Alav Shalom. He opened them up. He dug them again. The Gemara said that the same way that Avraham Avinu, he was a big man who converts people and to make them discover Hashem, Yitzhak Avinu followed his steps as well. That's what he did. Or, here the Torah wants to teach us how much you have to fight to keep on going in your Judaism. Yitzhak Avinu, Alav Shalom, all the education that he received from his father, to try to stop him, to make him change. Eh, your father, he was a special man. Now that he died, you have to change. You have to live like us. And they wanted to make him change his mind, to give him influence, bad influence. This is the meaning of the wills. And there was a fight against the temptation, all kind of temptation, bad temptation of that time. And there was a fight between Elimelech and people, and Yitzhak people, who was what direction to take. Yitzhak Abinu wanted to carry on teaching the direction of Avraham Abinu, his father, the way he teach them to believe in Hashem. And the opposite, he said, no, now it's finished. Abraham died. He said, now there is a new generation, there is new equipment, there is today new technology, there is a modernism, we have to change. The way of your father, it's old time, it's an old way. It's no good. And Avraham, it's Agabino, he fight them. So when it's Abimelech, he saw that he cannot beat Yitzhak and his influence, so he told him, get out from here, go. Go away from us. You become too much stronger than us. If people will follow you, then I will not remain the king here. So get out from here. So he was not embraced Yitzhak. He went from there and he dig another well and he start to carry teaching Torah to people. And here you are, the people of Avimelech, they come and quarrel with him, they fight with him. And again, and Isaac dug anew the ways of water. Which they had dug in the days of Abraham his father. And the Philistine had stopped them up after Abraham's death. He opened them again. There was a fight between Abraham and Abimelech and the servant of Abimelech. And then, do you think he stopped? No, he carried on again. And they dig another well. And there was a fight. The Torah wants to teach us that with the Tzara there is always fight. The Tzara never will stop. Never will stop from bothering you. When the Tzara see that you become a religious, you become a man of Torah, he will not let you. He will fight you. He will bring you problems. This is the life. All your life, we have 70 years to live. Of course, whatever we live, more than 70 years, it's a gift. As David HaMelech said, we have 70 years to live. The rest is a gift. Whatever you live more than 70 years, it's a gift from us. Of course, we ask from Hashem that kind of gift, to live more than 70 years old. And then, what happened at the end? That Isaac, Yitzhak, he dig another well, and there was no fight. The meaning is, the Yitzhara, he will fight you. You beat him, he will try again. But one day, he will stop. And then the Torah said, and Hashem appeared to Yitzhak. He appeared to Yitzhak. What that means, you have to affect Yitzhak. The meaning is, when you beat the Yetzer Harah, you discover, the more you beat the Yetzer Harah, the more he fight you, the more you beat him, so at the end, you discover satisfaction. You feel Hashem. That's what the Torah said. And Hashem appeared to Yitzhak after all those fights. And then what Yitzhak did, he built a mizbeah. He built a hotel of sacrifice for Hashem. Thank to say Hashem, thank you now that I beat the Yetzer Harah. Thank you for your help. Because the Gemara said, if Hashem doesn't help you how to beat the Yetzer Harah, you cannot beat him. The Yetzer Harah is fire. It's fire. It's fire. And then the Torah said, oh, now that I beat him, now he built a mizbeah to thank him. And again, the Torah said, he dig a well. That means, when you feel Hashem, you have to be careful. Now you have to be stronger and stronger by being connected to Hashem. You should not stop. Because a lot of times, you may think, well, I reached it, my level now. I fight the Yetzer Harah, I beat him, now I feel Hashem, I'm connected to Hashem. I reached my level. No, you can reach more than the level that you reached. You can carry on. And then the Torah said that Avimelech came to Yitzhak. That means that when you beat the Yetzer Harah will agree. The Gemara said that the Yetzer Harah, once he's beaten, he tried to beat you, but when you beat him, then the Yetzer Harah, he goes to Hashem and tell him, Hashem, this man is a tzaddik. He beat me. He beat me. This is the meaning. Avimelech came again to Yitzhak and he told him, please, let's do peace. You beat me. The Torah said Yitzhak, he said to Avimelech, okay, I do peace with you, but you go your way and I go my way. And quick, once he went, he built another well. He dig another well. That means that it doesn't mean because now he did peace with the Yetzer Harah, that Yitzhak, he did peace with Avimelech, so he will live next to him and he will have his influence. Now, it's a peace of separation. If a shalom, that stay away, keep yourself there, I'm here. We cannot be together. And Yitzhak Abinu quickly built another well. And he called him Be'er Sheva, the well of seven. The meaning that as long as I live 70 years, I have only to dig and dig and dig to find water, to find Torah. No peace in my life. As long as I live, I have to fight the Yetzer Harah. So you see this story. It's fabulous. And that's why the Torah is telling. I don't see the meaning why the Torah tells you this story. Only because the Torah wants to teach you something. Wants to teach you in life, in the day's life, it's a fight. Like Shlomo HaMelech said, Adam le'amal yulad. A man who was born just to suffer, just to work. You must know, a man that he doesn't work, a man that he doesn't do nothing, he will get bored. A man should do something. Adam le'amal yulad. You have to suffer, you have to do efforts. You cannot just live without doing nothing. Most of the people that they don't work or they don't do nothing, or just all the day watching television or eating, sleeping, at the end we finish with nerves breakdown, because you have to do something, you have to work, or to study Torah, or work, go to business, or you have to do something. I mean, you cannot just stay without nothing, doing nothing. And you know, we said that, when you don't do nothing, you get bored. when a man gets bored, he become lazy. If he become lazy, then he may think bad thoughts. Who knows what can happen? So Hashem, Baruch Hashem. Hashem, he did something incredible, because somebody asked me, why did Hashem had to create the Yetzer Harah? Why? So I said, because Hashem, he wants you to fight. Because if you don't fight, you get bored. Be'emet, I'm telling you. Baruch Hashem, there is Torah. Because I occupy my life. I keep this mitzvah. Baruch Hashem, all my life is occupied. I'm telling you. Baruch Hashem, I eat, I sleep, I enjoy myself. But my life is occupied. Most of my thoughts are, I want to do this mitzvah. And Baruch Hashem, I can do a lot of mitzvot. Look, there is a lot of people who do business. They have a big business. And Baruch Hashem, they are big businessmen, and they keep Torah and mitzvot. Their life is always occupied. They're occupied by Torah, and occupy with business, and Baruch Hashem, they are healthy, they are good. They are the first Rothschild. The first Rothschild, he was a big Talmid Chacham. He was a millionaire, he was a billionaire, he was very rich. At the time, there was no computer, there was no telephone, there were no Facebook, no internet, nothing. And he was very well known all over the world. And he was as well a big Talmid Chacham. He used to study Torah. I heard in Mexico something incredible. I think 25 years ago, when it was there, a big earthquake, you know, and the downtown Mexico, most of the downtown was destroyed. And something incredible happened there. There was a building, nearly all the building was destroyed, but not in the third floor. The first floor remained completely intact. It was incredible that the downstairs stores, they were most of them destroyed, but in other rooms, except the amudim, without the building was standing. But most of the rooms were destroyed, but that third floor was completely intact. And no one could understand. And they realized that in that third floor, it happened something, that every day there was there Shiori Torah. They were there every day, a room to pray, and another room to study Torah for all the Jews that they live in the area, or they have business in the area. It's a Torah Magina Matzah, the Torah protect. I mean, Baruch Hashem, Baruch Hashem, Baruch Hashem. The Torah gives you joy. The Torah gives you. It's fabulous. The Melech said, "Ta'amu o kitov Hashem." If you just test it, the same way that when you test the money, you get satisfaction that with the money you can buy anything you want. You can have the best houses, you can the best holidays. With the money, you can have everything you want. The Torah, the beauty of the Torah, it's inimaginable. You can imagine the pleasure that you get from the Torah. This week, I couldn't sleep for a reason, I don't know why, but Baruch Hashem, I was studying Torah, and when I saw the watch was already at 5 o'clock, when I went to bed, my wife, she was up to start to prepare the food for my grandson. And she told me, "You don't sleep?" I said, no. What time is it now? I didn't want to tell her it's 5 o'clock. I said, well, it's 11 o'clock. Ah, so go to bed, go to sleep. And then we saw the watch. She said, "You're kidding." It's 5 o'clock in the morning. I said, Vivian, you cannot imagine the beauty of the Torah. It's so nice, it's so good. When you start learning Torah, you can't stop. You can't, Bemet, honestly, it's so nice, it's so good to understand the Torah, to understand what Hashem gives you. And Nehemadim is Zahav Pazrav. Tukim Midivat Shufit Sufim. David the Meir said that you can get maybe the pleasure from money, from gold, from diamond, but the pleasure that you can get from the Torah is no value. The Torah has no value. It's beautiful. It's nice. At the beginning, it's hard. You have to fight to keep Shabbat. You have to fight to keep Nida. You have to fight to do this mitzvah. You have to fight. At the beginning, everything is hard. Sometimes he beat you. Sometimes you beat him, the Yitzhara. And sometimes the Yitzhara, he push you to do what your father teach you to do, what the Rebbe teach you to do. And then you do the contrary, you don't do it. And then you fight him. And then again you fight him, and he tried to beat you. And at the end, you beat him. And then you feel like this morning. This morning, I want to sleep very late because I had a big shiur last night. And I had to wake up at 4 o'clock. And then it was very, very hard for me to wake up at 4 o'clock. And honest, with difficulty, I woke up. Once I woke up, and once I started to study Torah, you cannot imagine how much I was happy. But listen to this. I woke up to give a shiur at 5 o'clock in the morning. It was hard for me. And then I tried to call the man with who I had the shiur, and I don't know for a reason, maybe if he forgot to put his telephone, maybe he went to bed, I don't know. So it's like the Sarah told me, go to bed now. Now that it's nothing, it's only 5 o'clock in the morning, go to bed. And I said, no. I said, I will study Torah. And you cannot imagine, once I started to study Torah, you cannot imagine how happy I was. Bam it, you cannot imagine. And I said to Hashem, thank you Hashem that I woke up. So you see that the Satan, when it comes to religion, the Tzara will not let you do it. And you have to fight. And once you fight and you beat him, you feel happiness. You feel yourself so close to Hashem. And you feel so close to Hashem. And then what you should do, now that you feel so close to Hashem, so now you know that what can make peace to Hashem. It's the way that you do. So carry on. So carry on. Carry on that way. And when you carry on that way, the Satan, the Tzara, he realized that really you beat him. Now that you are protected from Hashem and himself, now, so he tried to do shalom with you. But you have to be careful. The shalom with him is a shalom of separation. A shalom of separation. You know, the Benish Hai, he asked a question. He said, how in the parasha of Vayeitzei, Abraham, Yaakov, when he left his Laban with all his family, and he ran away from there, from Haran. So Laban, he went after him, he catch him. So Laban, he said to Yaakov, why you run away from me? Why you didn't tell me bye-bye? Even bye-bye, you didn't let me kiss my children, my daughters, my grandchildren. So there was a big fight between them, a fight of words. So Laban, he said to Yaakov, okay, so now let's do a peace. Let's do shalom, let's do a bridge, let's do an alliance between you and me. So Yaakov, he said, okay, let's do an alliance, Brit, between you and me. I would like just to find out exactly what the name of this Brit. It's incredible. Memdalet. So Laban said, so now come, let us make a covenant. I and you. and he shall be a witness between me and you. Then Yaakov took a stone and raised it up like a monument. And Yaakov said to his children, "Let's build this monument." So they took stones and made them, and they made like a mountain. And they eat there on the mountain. And Laban, he called this place, he called it Yagar Shahaduta. And Yaakov called it Gilad. And Laban declared, "This mound is a witness between me and you today." They built like a gal, like a wall. And they said, so the Benish Hai asked a question, "This is a Brit? This is an alliance? This is a separation? What it is a Brit, an alliance? Like we shake hands. We are together. This is the Brit. Like a man who married a woman, he take the ring and he put it in his finger and he tell her, with this ring on your finger, you are my wife. I give you this, now you are my wife. You belong to me. Ariat mikudeshitli. This is a Brit between them. We do the circumcision, the Brit Mila. When we do this Brit, it's an alliance between us and Hashem. To be connected to Hashem every day is through the tefillin. The woman, she's connected to Hashem through keeping Nida, Shabbos, when she light the candle on Shabbos, and when she bake the bread and she take the challah. This is a kind of Brit. When we keep Shabbat, it's a Brit. It's an alliance between us and Hashem. But how can you call a Brit an alliance between you and me when I build a wall that separates us? I mean, this wall is a separation, it's not a Brit. It's not a Brit. So that was the question of the Ben Ish Hai on the Torah, Parashat Vayeitzei. And I give an answer. I said, this is a kind of Brit of separation. The same way that there is a Brit, an alliance to be together, there is another kind of Brit that you don't come near me, I don't come near you. This is our alliance. This is so that we can live peaceful. We don't need to shake hands to be peaceful. Let's build a wall, and this wall will be like no war, no fight, no peace. This wall will remind you, will remind me that this wall is symbolic that we are in peace, that no war, no peace. So now you understand the story of Abimelech. You see, I'm telling you that Yaakov Abinu, he only followed the steps of his father Yitzhak. When Yitzhak made a peace with Abimelech, it was a peace, not a peace that we will be together. No, it's a peace of separation. Because quick after doing this peace with him, what he did, he dig a well of water and he found water. Quick, he beat a mizbeah, and quick, he find their water. That means, my meaning to you, Abimelech, I don't want to follow. We are in shalom, you and me, but I will carry on my way to follow the step of Hashem. Studying Torah, keeping digging wells. Soothing Torah. That was the kind of peace, alliance that a man will do with the Tzara. When the Tzara, he realized that he's beaten, then he give up. When he give up, he come to the man to try again, peacefully. I don't want to fight you. You beat me. Okay, I beat you. Okay, get out from here. We're in shalom. Our shalom between you and me, it's get out from there. I know my way. And then quick, Avraham, Yitzhak Avinu, alav shalom, He gave us a derech. As long as we live, 70 years as we live, we should be full of Torah. Then as soon that he went, Abimelech, the king told him, hey, Yitzhak, we find water, another water. That's why they call it Be'er Sheva. It's for Be'er Sheva. Be'er Sheva is the well of seven. We know that the world will remain 6,000 years, as the Zohar Kadosh said. The world was created in 6 days. 6 days is the equivalent of 6,000 years. And the end of these 6,000 years is the new 1,007. Then Mashiach will come. The world will not exist more than 6,000. Well, people, they talk about that the world is older, millions of millions of billions of years. Well, according to our religion, the world is only old less than 6,000 years. Of course, no one will believe me, but I believe to the Torah. Of course, if people believe the Torah, if people believe that there was one day the deluge, the Mabul, when the water failed and destroyed the world, it was water, hot water, of thousands of degrees. It was so hot, so all the world changed. It's like you take a chicken and you boiled it on hot water, 1,000 degrees in water for 1 year. And after 1 year, put the carbon cut, the carbon 14, and tested how it is. Of course, it's false. It gives you a false direction, false estimation. Maybe you will think it's 10,000 year old or 1 million year old. So I don't want to go into the details of. So of course today we define something and they tested how old it is. They found it's very very old. Well, they don't, because they don't bring in consideration that the Mabul, the deluge, was filling. You know. The deluge, the water, the hot water, Hashem destroyed, he renewed the world. And this renew the world, it make that the world is old, and all those animals, that if dinosaur, all those animals they defined, and the estimation, it's 100 million year old, and 200 million old, or 1 billion, well, the estimation, it's based according to carbon 14, but I'm sorry to tell you, we don't. According to the Torah, it's only, according to the Torah, the world is only old 6,000 years. Less than 6,000 years. And this is the meaning of Be'er Sheva. Be'er Sheva, that as young as the world will remain till the end of the 6,000 years, you have to fight the Sarah. When the end of 6,000 years will come, today the Jewish calendar is 5,771. So, when Be'et Hashem, the time of Mashiach will come after the 6,000 years, then there will be no Yetzirah anymore. This is Be'er Sheva. As long as we live, as long that we remain on earth till Mashiach will come, that was the message of Yitzhak Avinu. As long as we live, as long as Mashiach did not come yet, because now we are waiting for him, we have to dig and dig and dig deeply to find water. Water is the Torah. To dig, to understand Torah. To fight the Yetzirah, who wants to stop us with all kind of technology, of things, just to make us taking another way, and not to be attached to the way of Hashem. It's a big fight, especially in our generation. and there is a new generation to come. It's going to be more harder and more harder. But one thing we know, the more we are attached to Hashem, the more we will feel the presence of Hashem. And the more we feel the presence of Hashem, we have to continue, not to think we reach the level. No, carry on, because if you feel that you reach your spiritual level, then you will start to descend. So you have to go up and up, Michael Chayil, and be careful. Once the Tzara will find that you beat him, he will come to you as a rabbi. He will come to you as a friend. Be careful. You can, like the Torah said, it's Ram B'Yadam, the Tzadikim, the Tzara is in their hand. In their hand, they watch him. So he will come. He will come nicely to you to tell you, you beat me, I want to be nice with you. Be careful. Get out from him. Get away. You can't show him, okay, I'm your friend, but get out. I'm your friend only if you are away from me. This is our friendship. If you are away from me, if you are near me, I'm not your. You are not my friend, I'm not your friend. And then you will discover again, new, more Torah to come into your mind. You will discover how much Hashem is good. And that's the end of the story. The end of the story is as long as you live, the 70 years as you live, or more if you live, you have to be always fighting the Tzara. Never let him be near you. Always dig and dig and dig to find more water, to be always attached to the Torah Kedusha. Always, 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 always. And he will try to make peace with you. You make peace with him, but a peace of separation. And then you will discover Hashem. And then we discover Mother Torah. And all this for all generations till Mashiach will come. That's why it called it Be'er Sheva, the well of seven. Because every thousand years is a fight, a new fight. The Tzara will come with new weapon, as we know all the stories of the years. Always there is new kind of Tzara that the generation invent, and we have to fight this Tzara and to be like me. Baruch Hashem, we have everything modern in our house, but our mind is modern too, but God forbid, we are always attached to Hashem, to the Torah Kedusha. Never, never, never do the mistake. Never, never, never. We can be attached to Hashem, feel Hashem, and be careful. To be very, very, very careful. This is what the Torah wants to teach us. My friend, once now we read the story of the wells, what the wells that the servant of Yitzhak dig, and the Philistines fill them of water, of earth. Afar is earth. Afar is from the word pe'ar. Pe'ar, it's a distance. It's a big distance. That means that the Philistine, that the Yetzerah, he wants to create a distance, a big pe'ar between you and Hashem. This is I try to explain to you that the Torah wants to teach us. It's a Torah. It's a book of Musar, a book of morale. The Torah wants to teach you how to live, how to behave. This is the relationship between all the story of wells on water, Philistine, Avimelech. It's like the Torah, she built a story, but the real meaning of that story about Abimelech, Yitzhak, and the servant, and the ways, and Dikin, and the peace, all this is the way how it happened between a man and the Yetzerah. And because Yitzhak, and why the Torah did not build this story on Abraham or Yaakov, because Yaakov was a man of Torah, why the Torah don't tell us this kind of story, because Yitzhak was a symbol of the Gvorah. Yitzhak was symbolic. Gvorah, Gvorah, that means sacrifice. That means the fighter, Gvorah, strong. And you know, Yitzhak, he sacrificed himself. To sacrifice yourself to Hashem, you need to be a strong man. And that's what was Avraham, Yitzhak Avinu. And that's where the story was built around Yitzhak, to tell you that to fight the Sahara, you need really to be a big fighter. Really, it's not easy. You need Miserut Nefesh, you need sacrifice. And so we learn from Yitzhak. If Yitzhak did it, so we can do it. And you learn from Yitzhak that you don't lose. Because that way, the Torah warns you, the Satan will try to disconnect you from the education that your father teach you. Will try to disconnect you from Hashem. So he will prove you that the way to live is the best, that the way that your father teach you is nothing, is no good. So you have to fight. You have to fight and fight. Then maybe the Tzara will beat you. You have to fight him. So you beat him. And at the end, you feel relief. Ah, now the Tzara let me. I beat him a few times. That's it. It's like a dog. A dog, he jump on you. You beat him. He will try again. You beat him. After he look at you, he run away. Even a lion, he will try to beat you, to eat you. Then you fight him. And then the lion, he will pull off his face, and he will feel that he was beaten, he will go. Maybe he will be your friend. Maybe he will come because you beat him. So that's what the Torah wants to teach you. Fighting for the Torah. To be beaten is the worst. Hashem will give you strength. With the Torah you can beat him up. And then at the end, he will try, you will discover Hashem. Then you will be to Hashem a Mizbeah. Mizbeah is you. You make yourself as a Mizbeah to Hashem. Hashem, now that I'm closer to you, I be the Sarah, my body, now, all my body, all myself, it's for you. But that's not enough. Because the Sarah, when you see that now you are 100% for Hashem, he will try to catch you with peace, with shalom. But you have to be careful. You have to be very careful from him. And then, at the end, what's going to happen? You will discover more Hashem. But this fight should remain till the end of the world, till the end of your life, till the end of the 6,000 years. Till Mashiach come. This is the meaning of the story of the wells and Yitzhak that it's in Torah. And quick, after this story of wells and digging and all fights with the servant of Avimelech, the Torah tells us the story now about Esav and Yaakov. Quick! And then the Torah tells us the story of Esav and Yaakov and all the fights that they had between them, and how Yaakov, he got the brachot, the blessing from Yitzhak, the way of two brothers, that instead of that Esav, we learn the teaching from Yitzhak, his father, the way he fights, the Yitzhara, the way he fights, the way how to live as a Jew. He took another step. He took another derech, another way. But Yaakov Abinu, alav shalom, exactly, he follows the steps of Yitzhak, his father. Yaakov ishtam yushevu alim. Yaakov was sitting, studying Torah, doing mitzvot, and when he left Be'er Sheva, all the people missed him. That was Yaakov Abinu alav shalom. And that the Am Yisrael should be. Now, from now, we talk only about Yaakov. The Torah focus, the Torah talk only about Yaakov and his generation, this is the Bible, till they went to Egypt, till they received the Torah, until they entered Israel after the death of Moshe Rabbeinu. That was the derech of Abraham Rabbeinu. He teach it to Yitzhak, and Yitzhak it was Gvura, and Yitzhak now he teach his son the way to behave, the way to act, how to fight the Yetzer Harah. And we say, Yaakov Abinu, when he took the brachot, when he took the blessing from Yitzhak Abinu, before he went to get married, he went to the yeshiva for 14 years. And then from there, he went to the yeshiva. It's incredible. Incredible. It's incredible parasha. How much we must learn from this. I would like to wish you Shavua Tov, and I hope that you understand. I hope that you learn all the meaning of this parashiyot. It's fabulous. It's like the Zohar Kadosh said. The Zohar Kadosh said that the Torah is like a etzot to teach you how to live. To teach you, because it's not easy. We live in a world of technology, a world of Yetzer Harah, of a lot of temptation. And we have to remain normal. And to remain normal, Bnei Adam, we need a lot of how to live. That we live as a man. So Baruch Hashem, here is some examples. From Yitzhak Abin, you learn something. From Abraham, you learn something. We learn, like the Rav Shach Alav Hashem said, that the best book that we can learn how to live as a human being is when we learn the stories about Abraham and Yaakov. I would like to wish you Shavua Tov. God bless you. Thank you.